So first, oh.
Oh.
All right. Oh.
Okay. So the paper that I chose this month to discuss is actually Promises and Perils of Mine in GitHub. And the reason that I chose this was like, I always just know like GitHub, all those awesome stuff is now available. You have all those public repos. Just let mine them, just like find some cool stuff around it. But in reality, like how many people just are putting up in GitHub stuff for their personal use that they can easily give it to someone else. So it's a lot of people need are doing it. So if you're looking at projects where people are collaborating on it, then you need to put all those things away. So indeed, like, get rid of all of them. So that's like stuff that you actually were researching in this paper. So like, what are the things that you all need to take care of before you know which project you can take from Git for finding awesome stuff, how people are actually collaborating on GitHub, that you can do awesome stuff by software research. So we have two papers of this. One is on the software mining conference, the ones that I say here, Conference on Mining Software Repositories, and then you have a longer version which is 40 pages, which you nicely can find online, where they're saying some extra things about it. So, as first giving some extra background, like a lot of people know that GitHub. Git is just a subversion control system. You can work with repos and have just a command line tool. GitHub actually makes it possible to host your repos online. You have the fork and pull model. And on GitHub, you still have like a lot of own features, like where you can actually collaborate on it. Put up some discussions, and then you have private and free accounts, and here we're mostly interested in the free accounts because they're the public ones, and that's the stuff that you actually can be mining. What are we thinking of GitHub? So we have 10 million repos in GitHub since January 2014, so an awesome source, you have a lot of public hosted projects, you have issues, pull request commits, comments and subscriptions. You have a nice API that researchers actually can use to pull out data out of it for doing some cool analysis. You have GitGH Torrent, which is actually making snapshots of all the events that are happening in GitHub. And each 2 months they're putting them online so that you can actually download them, do your analysis on it, so that you don't need to worry yourself really about first gathering all the data. But indeed, not everything is used for collaboration. Not every project hosts code, and also not every project is active anymore. And therefore, indeed, the authors of this paper therefore were saying, okay, you first need to research this for knowing how this will actually influence the validity of our claims of our research that we will be doing. And what are they using in here in this peer paper? So they start from a survey of questions. There's 1,000 questionnaires. Sorry, they send out 1,000 questionnaires. They got 240 responses back. Based on that, they identified some perils. Then for showing that the perils really are true, so showing some numbers for it, they use the GH Torrent dataset. And then also, not everything would be nicely determined from that dataset. They also sampled 434 GitHub repos, and based on this, they were actually checking out, like, they labeled them, for example, also like different type of projects that they were, so you can read it in here what they actually exactly meant with that, but like for sometimes indeed they needed to use these for showing some extra stuff. And then they did also some risk analysis on the data set that they had for the MSR 14 mining challenge. I will explain this one also in a later slide, but this is just like data source that they give that people can mine and find some.
MSR is in Microsoft Research? Or?
No, the conference from here, what I said in the beginning. So, mining software repositories, and they have like each year a data challenge where you can find stuff on Stack Overflow, do an analysis, or compare different open source projects. And one 2014, they worked on GitHub. So. Okay. So, what are some perils that they found? So they have on 3-4 different levels actually. So project perils, they have user perils, GitHub related perils, and pull request related perils. So these are the 7.7 important ones for project related. So not each repo is a project. Most projects have low activity. Most projects are inactive. Many projects are not for software development. Most projects are personal. Many projects do not use GitHub exclusively, but you need also, can imagine, you're putting your information always in needles in different sources. And few projects use pull requests. For the ones that I have here in green, I just will show some extra information from it. Really going to all of them in the nitty gritty would be a bit too boring, but just indeed having a bit of an idea. And okay, then indeed here you have like pull request related perils. Merges only track successful code. That's more something that's related to the API of GitHub that you will be able to use for doing your research. Many merge pull requests appear as non-merge. This I found a bit a tricky one, but I also explained this later on. This one should have been a bit smaller. So yeah, user-related perils. Not all activity is due to presence of users. That just means like you have sometimes, yeah, it's just done outside of the project and then pulled in. And only users' public activity is visible. Therefore, these projects might seem to be inactive, but actually they're not. Just the activity is not public. And then you have GitHub related. GitHub's API does not expose all data, and GitHub is continuously evolving. So repo is not necessarily a project. What do they mean here? You have your main project. You want to add some extra stuff to do it as a contributor. So you first need to fork. You need to do your changes there, and then you need to have like a pull request and the real contributor, so the core contributors, then you need to say, okay, this is good, and then it can be merged again. So therefore, indeed, this way, you might have the same project, several pieces actually that are existing. So, and therefore, what they say, how can you avoid this? If you're using a project, make sure that you also are analyzing all those ones that are related with this. So this is the ones that are forked up. And next one is most projects have low activity. So what you're plotting in here is the number of commits in the project. See, now they put here a logarithmic scale. They put the cumulative proportion, and then you actually see like the median number over here with the 50% is 6, and the median number of commits for a project is only 6 that you have. And then indeed also you nicely see like 90% of the projects have less than 50 commits. So you really have like the bigger ones who account for all the big activity. So it's, and then you also nicely see that you can put this in the Lorentz curve. So it's like this is showing like if everything, for example, it comes from economics of the Lorentz curve. If you have a good distribution of wealth, then always like so many percent of wealth of the people belongs, or so many percent, 80% wealth of the people also have 80% of wealth. So that you have always a nice distribution. Indeed, the more inequality you have, the more this curve will go lower. And indeed, there you also indeed see like it's only like this and percent of the project indeed accounts for so many commits. So it's really interesting to see. And it is also like, you know it yourself, like you might put something on GitHub and not look into it for a really long time. Just really enthusiastic in the beginning and then you think, okay, just leave it out. Similar one is indeed, like I say, most projects are inactive. And how can we measure this? So we have two nice graphs in here, and they are the activities since January 2014, number of months since last commit. And then you see which one was the project coming in. That was the, wait, I believe one was the project created the last 6 months, and the other one was the project and the number of commits. So which one?
Red line is created.
Headline is 70. Here you have number of projects were created during those months, and then over here you see the number of months since the last commit, and then you see you need that you need nicely have like, well, just remaining majority of the project and each become inactive, which also need this, what you might expect, but it's nice to see it in reality going over. And anyway, similar, you also see here the days of activity since creation, and you also see the most projects are pretty active in the beginning, and then just they nicely die out. Not really nicely, but just. So, but how does this influence if you indeed want to perform some analysis on those projects? Then they say, look for projects that have a decent number of commits that are going on, and also avoid claims of generalization if you perform research and you find stuff on the really active projects, because it's only like a small subset of what is really available in GitHub. So, indeed, like you say, many projects are not software development projects, and for this one, they used the sample set, the 434. It's interesting, you can see in here what they all applied for labeling them, manually labeling 434 projects. It's even not a fun thing to do, but it had some cool stuff around it. And then you see 275 of them were software development. Then you have 12% experimental, you have storage, academic, you have web, and then you still have also some projects which are not available anymore. So it's nice to keep in mind if next time you just put something on GitHub where it eventually will belong to, how you might frustrate some other people.
Do you know what those terms kind of represent? I'm not sure what experimental means or web means.
It means we don't know.
Actually, they defined it in the paper. Experimental was, I think it was like, this is where things like tutorials and demos got put into experimental. Storage was stuff like dot files, academic or like class projects and like student projects and websites and stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's what web is?
Yeah, web is like your GitHub website or your like one-off three-page static, whatever, like just not big projects, but just small website-y things.
Okay.
So like web pages as opposed to web applications.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Like HTML.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pure.
Just yeah. Arizona HTML and Markdown files in here. All
right.
Web. A shockingly small amount, actually, given the popularity of GitHub pages.
Yeah, maybe also just depending on the sample set that they have. They try to do it a bit realistically, but yeah.
Yeah, sample size.
But indeed, it's. Yeah. So how can you avoid getting your own projects? So not only rely on the file types in repos, because in the programming files you can also have them. In the experimental stuff, certainly review the descriptions, review the README files, and then make sure indeed that you have selected the projects that you really need for your study. Okay. Pull request related to Perils. So GitHub only the successful merges are tracked. That's for the API, and I understood it. So you only But intermediate commits, you actually want get back in the information. And indeed, it would be nice indeed to see also if stuff goes wrong for tracking this. And many merged pull requests appear as non-merged. Reason behind this is that you have three different strategies of merging. So you can just use the tools of GitHub to merge. You can with the merge button, so then drive is easy. And otherwise, you can use just the Git facilities to merge, or you can do a textual patch, what they call commit crashing. And those ones, we don't have them immediately available. And so it's also, like you say, only the merges to the pull request can be nicely detected. And so the other two types will be seen as unmerged. Therefore, they define four heuristics that you actually can use. The extra check which pull request will be, which pull requests are also merged. So you can need to look, for example, whether the pull request also appears in the master branch. Look for certain words like fixes. And you also have here a nice regular expression that you need to look for, and then also indeed they appear to be merged, and then you also basis commit prior to closing, the pull request matches also this regular expression. Then you see some nice numbers here, and actually, yeah, still have some that are missing here. Table's a bit gone too low. But what you actually see, so of the public data sets of 2.5 million, 44% appear to be merged, only so through the pull request. Then indeed they wanted to investigate this further and looked into the data set of the 434 samples. And what did they see? So 37% used the GitHub facilities, but with applying the four heuristics, they still got to 32% to the first one, 1% to the second heuristic, and then still 5% and 4% towards the third and fourth heuristic. So this just having this extra heuristic, they still have much more data that they actually will be able to research through this. Only public activity is visible, so indeed, and there it's nice to see. Indeed, accounts might seem to be inactive, but actually they are all doing their work of development work private. And then you still need to sub the accounts up in two parts. In the first part of the users, they don't have a public repo. The other ones, they have a public repo, but they are empty or they are just forks with no activity. And then we have needs about how the people need still have at least one commit. And this is actually something that you not really can avoid because you're working with a public data set. And this is indeed nicely again show a number of commits of users, and then you see 50% of the users, they have actually
less than one commit.
Yeah. Less than
smaller.
Yeah.
And so some GitHub specific stuff for mining, and that's indeed why GitHub does not give you all the data. So we have a nice API, but it's not exposing everything that you might need. Another way is going to the repo level of the API, but then only 300 events back or stored. And also not all events have a timestamp. And then you have also renaming the entity, so the URLs are nicely changed, but in the API, the things are now changed. And delete the repos, yeah, similar stuff. If the repo becomes private, it seems to be deleted, and all those nice kind of stuff. But they say here as an avoidance strategy is use the GH direct data set that is available for an example. So, and now they put up a nice summary of all of these perils. So how do you need to read it? They selected first all the perils which were all the repos that were subjective to the first peril, so repos that have forks, so therefore you have 100 everywhere here. That's just the way they pick them, and then they are saying if you have a repo that is subjective to one of those perils, then indeed checking like which ones do they also have issues with, and then indeed they set the this guy needs, and he said indeed these ones are the ones that have most issues indeed. And what you nicely say behind this is knowing these rules based on this analysis, they set up some rules how you can pick nicely your repos, choose repos that have forks, and exclude repos that are inactive or predefined period of examination, and from those ones, exclude repos that never had received a pull request because indeed probably was not much useful activity in there. Now we come to the MSR mining challenge. So we have like a workshop of International Working Conference on Mining Software Repositories. They have each year a mining challenge, so since 2006. And their goal is to bring research and industry more together by analyzing a common data source. Here are some projects that they had over the last years, comparing Eclipse and NetBeans, Firefox and Chrome, analyze findings that they had in the Android platform, looking at Stack Overflow data. 2014, they got 90 GitHub projects. And now this year they had comparing information or analyzing information found in Stack Overflow. Actually, what to me is a bit sad if you don't look at the challenge, what is actually the prize? It's really small. So it's like, it's really just indeed more like the people want to have a nice paper out of it, but it's not going to make you rich if you find something nice in here. So. But yeah, so they combined their findings on this data set from the showing like, yeah, data set used in this conference is good or it's bad. And therefore, indeed, they took 90 repos from the 10 top programming languages. They chose the 10 most active repos for pull requests in 2013. And then indeed, they still did some manual cleaning for checking whether the projects were really nice. And then they were checking were the perils no issue for this one, and indeed they nicely saw project indeed they were active indeed because it's the way they chose them. They were for software development because they were those 10 programming languages and were hand cleaned. Most projects are personal because they have big projects, so indeed obviously you have more people collaborating in it. Not all activities due to registered users was also not really an issue, and few projects use pull requests because they choose ones with top pull requests indeed. They also didn't have that issue. The those ones were nicely avoided. However, the ones that still might indeed give issues here were merges only track successful code, many merge pull requests appear as non-merge, only the user's public activity is visible, GitHub API does not exclude all data, expose all data, and GitHub is continuously evolving, but there are things that are just inherent of GitHub, so you can't easily evoke them just by using different data sources. So, some take-home conclusions from this is if you're indeed reporting on small project properties, so like kinds of programming language uses, type of tools built, then the information that's available in GitHub is nicely to use. It's just, if you go to more abstract constructs and looking how developers are working together, then indeed you first need to assess the data that you want to use of GitHub, and then you need to target the data towards data that you actually can use for your research question. And therefore, it put up some nice recommendation. Consider a project that during a certain period of time had a good balance of number of commits and pull requests and have a number of committers larger than two that are nicely collaborating. And also keep in mind that other repos might exist in the project. And also make sure that GitHub is an evolving entity also, so the information that's exposed might change over time, also the API might change over time, and you need to factor that in your analysis. An example that they give here is that watched repos became like start repos over time, and therefore you need to make sure if you find stuff in your analysis that you're not finding the changes in the functionality in the API, but you're indeed really exposing the things that you're finding on the software research itself. And final recommendation that they say is don't only rely on GitHub, also look like to different kind of data. If you find things, try to do like some kind of surveys that you actually will be able to show your findings in a different, in an extra way, but also will make sure that there's more confidence in your research findings. Okay. Yeah, that was the paper. Yeah.
What kind of research questions have people tried to mine GitHub to answer?
It's like also looking like collaboration of what people are doing, and they have some nice examples here. I just didn't want to learn.
You know, should have read the paper.
Them by cars.
How awesome is Node?
Yeah.
Something super awesome. People are not meant to know.
There's the famous research project of finding your Amazon key
and. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh man. Searching for MySQL injection attacks. Yeah. It's so much fun.
Yeah, also the pretty popular project of finding out how much cursing people use in their comments. It's very popular.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. How successful projects become by working together. And there's also something like that you have, like that you can see when a project comes close to project completion, like the time between commits and everything has a certain level. And
okay.
Then you have the nice graphs that they have, like the animations, like how all the people are working together, so the graph is like really cool. And you see this person doing stuff and that person doing stuff, all in graph analysis, and then they hope to find cool stuff around it. So
unicorn predictor.
There was I didn't make it all the way to the end of the paper, but throughout the like description of the Perils, there was a lot of talk about looking at how the whole cycle from like issue report to pull request to fix of the code went.
Yeah.
Related.
Yeah, it's cool stuff that you can
find
around.
So I hear there somebody recreated the history of Unix in the GitHub repository. Am I the only person who heard that I hallucinate this?
It sounds like an hallucination.
I haven't encountered it.
Apparently somebody went through the history of Unix and recreated it as a GitHub repository with like the commit messages, not commit messages, but at least the committers' names. Ken Thompson did this.
Oh, cool.
Up to a year.
I assume it's not like all Unixes ever, but this is like...
At first hand,
the
original,
Bell Labs, not many. So. Did that count as experimental? I mean, it's actually software development.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. The repo in which they store the script they use to make the other repo is software development.
Yeah,
this
fair.
One
that's
is
fair.
This one is probably...
There was,
I don't know.
Is it a script?
It counts as a mirror, probably.
Exactly.
They
have
a category for mirrors, and I think that was...
Okay.
I think they call that storage, but I don't remember.
Yeah, things, but actual work went into this, right? I mean, this is not... This is a historical effort.
Fair enough.
it's not just the
wiki.
Yeah, it's history of software.
Yeah,
like,
it's the same
history
as,
of mathematics.
It's the same as what if you check in a whole bunch of drawings and that's your whole repo. It's not software development, but effort went into that.
Yeah.
Well, I just mean it's not like a mirror in the sense,
oh,
somebody
oh,
else
right.
was doing this and I was mirroring.
Of course,
it's not. It's,
but it
it's
also a, seems like this paper isn't specifically trying to figure out useless repos. It's specifically trying to figure out like studyable repos.
What do you
mean? It doesn't sound like there was a lot of. it doesn't sound like there was a lot of collaboration and pull requests. Like you wouldn't run research on that to figure out how workflows work, even if it's awesome and spent took time. It's not like
okay.
the data they were probably looking for.
Yeah.
All right.
And they just wanted to be sure if they had findings that people wouldn't say, but yeah, you're inactive on everything.
Yeah.
Just
so inactive since 1972.
Yeah.
So a good meta study here would be to see how many research papers use GitHub as data up until publishing of this, and how many use afterwards.
Yeah. Yeah, we still need to wait for a few years because the papers do not have been working. But
well, everybody else who came to the conference disappeared quietly without publishing.
I'm amazed that there's 11 years of conferences on this subject. This is the 11th conference on mining software repositories.
Yes,
when did SourceForge start?
Yeah.
Mm. Stack Overflow is there twice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They're running out of software repositories.
Everything is further ago than I think it is.
Are you looking in the mirror?
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Well,
thank you.